Welcome everyone, I'm Spiro, thanks for tuning in. We've all heard the phrase, never let a good crisis go to waste, and I would say that applies even if the crisis is engineered. We've also heard the phrase, order out of chaos, which is a strategy that I believe we are seeing unfold before our eyes. Now I'm sure that many of you are familiar with the Hegelian dialectic, which is problem, reaction, solution. If you have a goal of, let's say, global governance, you may not be able to just roll this out because you'll be met with resistance, and there may be little to no justification for this agenda. So you engineer a crisis, in this case, a global health pandemic, a scenario we have seen wargamed in documents such as the 2010 Rockefeller Lockstep document and Event 201, the tabletop exercise and simulation of a global coronavirus pandemic. That was sponsored by the World Economic Forum, Johns Hopkins, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which took place last October. This crisis, which I believe to be engineered, produces a desired response, a controlled demolition of the global economy, wiping out the middle class, creating more dependency upon the government in the form of stimulus money and bailouts, which essentially equate to ownership. We experienced the authoritarian lockdowns, which was the conclusion of the Rockefeller Lockstep document on how to mitigate this crisis. Now, we are also witnessing massive civil unrest under the guise of seeking social justice and ending inequalities and systemic racism, as they call it. When in reality, these riots are nothing more than an organized destabilization operation, much like the ones we have seen the US and the CIA carry out in countless countries before they topple their governments and install puppet regimes. This is a planned operation. So back to the problem-reaction-solution strategy. We have the engineered problem, COVID-19. We have the reaction, the economic collapse and the civil unrest, and now it's time for the solution. A solution which has already been predetermined, prepackaged, and ready to roll out. The solution was just announced by the World Economic Forum, the same World Economic Forum who asked Johns Hopkins to host Event 201. Their solution is what they are calling the Great Reset, an initiative that was officially launched this week. Now, the Great Reset is not a new idea that they just made up over the weekend, okay? This is a long-standing global governance agenda which ties into the United Nations 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, which seeks to regulate, control, and redefine all aspects of life as we know it. And in June of last year, the United Nations and the World Economic Forum formed a strategic partnership to accelerate the implementation of the UN 2030 Agenda. Now, here is a quote from the World Economic Forum about the Great Reset, directly from their website. In fact, one silver lining of the pandemic is that it has shown how quickly we can make radical changes to our lifestyles. Almost instantly, the crisis forced businesses and individuals to abandon practices long claimed to be essential, from frequent air travel to working in an office. Back in January of this year, 2020, the World Economic Forum founder and executive chairman Klaus Schwab was asked, "What can we expect to be the focus of Davos 2020? And he referenced his book from 1970 on a new economic model called stakeholder capitalism.
Well, thank you so much. And of course, it's the headquarters of the World Economic Forum, which is celebrating 50 years as its founder. What does that mean to you personally?
It doesn't mean celebrating 50 years of Davos or of our existence. For me, it means to celebrate 50 years of the stakeholder concept, of stakeholder capitalism, because I wrote the book in 1970 and conceptualized, probably for the first time, what we call today stakeholder capitalism. And I wanted to create a place where stakeholders could meet. And that was the original idea of Davos. So I'm very pleased and happy that we are not only celebrating 50 years, but we are celebrating now, finally, that stakeholder capitalism has become or is becoming mainstream.
When we look on the World Economic Forum's website, we see that stakeholder capitalism is one of the main objectives of this Great Reset. At the time of the interview back in January of 2020, the stock market was at all-time highs, and the sense of urgency for a new economic model really wasn't there.
I see also, I would call it, that we have urgency in emergency related to the environmental issues, climate change, but also biodiversity and so on. we face an emergency situation, and we have not yet really the sense of urgency to address those issues. We see it now with the fires in Australia, and of course it's relatively difficult to get such a sense of urgency if the stock markets are doing so well as we see now.
Now we have economic conditions comparable to that of the Great Depression due to the fallout from the coronavirus lockdowns. And now, lo and behold, we have the justification for the Great Reset and the 50-year-old plan for the new economic system. Now, just 3 days ago, the World Economic Forum hosted a virtual summit for the Great Reset. Attendees included Klaus Schwab, the founder of the World Economic Forum, the United Nations Secretary General Guterres, Prince Charles, the head of the International Monetary Fund, and a top representative from MasterCard, among many others. And the general consensus was that we cannot afford to miss this window of opportunity to implement the Great Reset because COVID has shown our current system to be broken.
The COVID-19 crisis has shown us that our old systems are not fit anymore for the 21st century. It has laid bare the fundamental lack of social cohesion, fairness, inclusion, and equality. Now is the historical moment, the time, not only to fight severe virus, but to shape the system for the need for the post-corona era.
The Great Reset is a welcome recognition that this human tragedy must be a wake-up call. As you rightly say, it is imperative that we reimagine, rebuild, redesign, reinvigorate, and rebalance our world.
But these are unprecedented times. Every person on the planet has been impacted by the coronavirus pandemic. Our world came to a standstill, and it became clear that we did not have the answer or the mechanisms to address such an unprecedented global threat. The threats posed by this dreadful pandemic came upon us suddenly with very little warning. The threat of climate change has been more gradual, but its devastating reality for many people and their livelihoods around the world, and its ever greater potential to disrupt, surpasses even that of COVID-19. We have a golden opportunity to seize something good from this crisis. Its unprecedented shockwaves may well make people more receptive to big visions of change. A global crisis like pandemics and climate change know no borders and highlight just how interdependent we are as one people sharing one planet.
History would look at this crisis as the great opportunity for reset. From the perspective of the IMF, what we see is inevitably a very massive injection of fiscal stimulus to help countries deal with this crisis and shift gear for growth to return. But it is paramount that this growth leads to a greener, smarter, and more fairer world in the future. I'm particularly keen to take advantage of the low oil prices today to eliminate harmful subsidies and to bring in place carbon price as an incentive for the investments for the future. Secondly, we know the digital economy is the big winner of this crisis.
We have a choice to remain passive, which would lead to the amplification of many of the trends we see today. Polarization, nationalism, racism, and ultimately increased social unrest and conflicts. But we have another choice. We can build a new social contract, particularly integrating the next generation. We can change our behavior to be in harmony with nature again. And we can make sure that the technologies of the fourth industrial revolution are best utilized to provide us with better lives. In short, we need a great reset.
According to the World Economic Forum website, the Great Reset Agenda would have three main components. The first would steer markets towards fairer outcomes, aka wealth redistribution through taxation and regulation. The second component of the Great Reset Agenda would ensure that investments advance shared goals, such as equality and sustainability, aka there will be global standards regulated by task forces to control every aspect of your life through regulation and ensure compliance to the 2030 Agenda. The third and final priority of the Great Reset Agenda is to harness the innovations of the Fourth Industrial Revolution to support the public good, especially by addressing health and social challenges, aka this is the transhumanist agenda to merge man with machine and enforce compliance with global governance initiatives laid out by the UN's 2030 Agenda. Now, this might be a good time to note that 14 of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals include vaccination.
I'm not going to talk about mandatory policy and where I stand on that point. It may well come up later, kind of hoping it does in the questions, because then I'll share with you my rather one-sided opinion on that. So what could be a better return on investment, Rob? What could we invest our resources in if we're not going to tackle hesitancy? If hesitancy is not to blame, how are we going to deal with this in the future? Well, I would argue that now is the time where we need a shift in perspective. Immunization is a best buy. 14 of 17 SDGs are addressed through immunization. And when we talk about universal health coverage, we talk about primary health care, we talk about health security, without immunization, there's none of that.
I want to focus on the third aspect of the Great Reset, the implementation of the Fourth Industrial Revolution, which Schwab has also written a book about and is a long-standing transhumanist agenda which seeks to merge man with machine and artificial intelligence, something that Elon Musk is already working on with his Neuralink project. Now, I'm going to play a series of clips from a World Economic Forum video published about 3 years ago talking about the Fourth Industrial Revolution. I will be commenting about these clips as we go.
We are wondering what is happening to the world. Everything is changing.
The very idea of human being some sort of natural concept is really going to change.
Our bodies will be so high-tech we won't be able to really distinguish between what's natural and what's artificial.
This is profound. She said the very idea of human beings being some sort of a natural concept is going to change, and that our bodies are going to be so high-tech we'll not be able to distinguish between what's natural and what's artificial. This is the merger of man and machine. This is the transhumanist agenda. This is the World Economic Forum's official video from their own YouTube channel.
Inside our own heads is the most complex arrangement of matter in the known universe.
You might ask yourself, can we get to be superhumans?
The original Industrial Revolution was driven by the discovery that you could use steam engines to do all kinds of interesting things.
But that was followed by additional revolutions for electricity and computers and communications technology. We're now in the early stages of the fourth industrial revolution, which is bringing together digital, physical, and biological systems.
One of the features of this fourth industrial revolution is that it doesn't change what we are doing, but it changes us.
There you just heard Klaus Schwab, the founder and executive chairman for the World Economic Forum, say that the fourth industrial revolution is going to change us, change humanity.
With the ability to visualize brain activity, for example, through a simple consumer-based EEG device, it gives us access to ourselves in ways that we've never before thought possible. It unlocks the black box that is the brain and enables us to really, truly be able to realize an identity that is aspirational.
there's now a scientific foundation for the effects of mindfulness on the brain, on the genome, on biological aging. And when the human mind does know itself, then you get the potential for a new renaissance that restructures itself in terms of our relationship to life, our relationship to the planet, our relationship to work.
We need a different economic model. And by that, I don't mean capitalism versus communism. What I'm talking about is a shift in the system along the lines of the two big changes that happened in the 20th century, Keynesianism, with a much greater focus on health and education and the role of government working with business, and then a reaction against that in late century to neoliberalism, where the focus was on free markets, freedom of the individual, and getting governments out of the way. We need a shift to a new system that will allow us to meet the basic needs of every human on the planet, that will live within planetary means, that will be fairer, and that will be focused as its key goal, not on growth per se, but on maximizing human well-being. And history tells us that a value shift is triggered by creation of a new story about how we want to live.
Now, they were talking about this new economic model not being based on hard work or being a business owner or creating wealth and success. They were talking about a new global economic order that will be fairer, they say, and essentially redistribute wealth, your wealth, as they see fit to lower the standards where you are in your countries or in some countries and raise them in others.
So the goal is no longer, I want to be less bad, less monotonous, less unsafe, less unjust. It's really about a diverse, safe, healthy, and just world with clean air, clean water, clean soil, clean energy.
Together we are fighting to preserve our fragile climate from irreversible damage and devastation of unthinkable proportions.
Are you beginning to see how this COVID crisis has accelerated the 2030 agenda and global governance? And how they use public figures such as celebrities to help sell it to the public because people do not trust governments and institutions. Now, of course, the fourth industrial revolution will be sold to humanity as a way to better mankind, a word which they don't want you to use. Mankind, the UN doesn't like that. They want humankind, right? Anyways, they will make paralyzed people walk again. They will help the blind to see. And while this is all amazing and great, history shows us that time and time again, things that could be used to benefit humanity are often weaponized and turned against humanity.
Humans have always been using tools, but because of the recent advances in technology, we're beginning to have machines that can augment us in all sorts of interesting ways.
I was the first person in the world to be able to voluntarily move my legs while stepping in a robot by exciting the nervous system using electrical stimulators directly onto the spine. We believe that a cure will be possible if enough of the right people have the will to fast-track a cure for paralysis.
The prediction of 5 million jobs lost by 2020 to technology is serious, but it's not the main question. Construction, manufacturing, services, public health and education, these industries will still exist. The main question is, what will be the future of work? How will we define work? How will we share the wealth?
One of the things that I think is so essential to free and open societies is freedom of thought. And up until now, the conversation we've been having is around freedom of speech. Once we can access people's thoughts and access people's emotion, we have to create a space that enables people to think freely, to think divergent thoughts, to think creative thoughts. And in a society where people fear having those thoughts, the likelihood of being able to enjoy progress is significantly diminished.
Did you just hear that? She said right now the discussion has been around free speech, but basically once we get that out of the way, once we get access to people's thoughts and once we get access to people's emotions, we need to create a framework for people to think in so people aren't scared and so people are safe. This is absolutely terrifying. Talk about thought police. They are fully intending and telling us right now that they plan to have direct access to your thoughts and to your emotions and be able to manipulate them as they see fit, of course, for the greater good.
We need to take responsibility at every level of society, from the individual and the personal to the institutional to the global, to adapt to these technological challenges and changes which are redefining what it means to be human, what it means to work, what it means to be completely embedded in this world.
This is not about saving the planet. This is not about equality. This is about control. Many of the jobs will be taken by robots, so they will redefine work and what it means to work. They want to redefine what it means to be human and determine for you your role and your future of being essentially a transhumanist cyborg integrated into this new control grid. Now, right now we are witnessing the controlled demolition of the current system of control by design in order to usher in this new transhumanist agenda, this new system of global governance, this new digitalized system of control where we will be unable to distinguish organic life from artificial. We won't even have access to our own thoughts, or we'll have access to them, but we won't even be able to control our own thoughts and emotions because they're going to do that for us, because we're going to be tied into their grid system. Now, the current system was never meant to last forever. It was meant to last only long enough to enslave humanity through debt and until technology caught up to the technocrats' envisioned future. And now it's here. Now, do you think that the central banks would take responsibility for the collapse of the current system? Do you think that the governments would take responsibility? No. The virus is here to take the fall. The virus will be the excuse to burn down this old system, as we're seeing happen right now, and out of the ashes this new system will rise. You think that it's just a coincidence that the central banks just so happen to have their new digitalized currencies ready to go? They've already been rebuilding the global infrastructure for years to facilitate this new digital financial system, this new digital financial system of control, which is about to be rolled out on all of us right now. At the same time, they are rolling out the digital immunity passports, and that the UN's digital identity plan is being rolled out and worked on right now, which is being funded and rolled out by Bill Gates. There's so much more. I could continue to go on, but for now, I'm going to have to cut it here. Global governance is at our doorstep. It's being rolled out under the justification of this COVID-1984 crisis. And at the end of the day, we the people do not have a say in our future, according to them. We don't even get a vote, according to them. These technocrats are deciding the future of humanity for us right now. And guess what? The future of humanity isn't human at all.